This is a World War II story of the first successful daytime bombing from high altitude. This is the story of the Royal Air Force No. 90 Squadron. Here's an introduction by Major Franklin Joseph.
The film you are about to see is 54 years old and dates back to the year 1940. The United States was not yet at war, and President Roosevelt had just signed the Lend-Lease Agreement with England, in which England gave the United States the right to use Bermuda and a few other bases, and we in turn gave England 50 overage destroyers from World War I, and various aircraft, including 20 Boeing B-17 bombers, and an unending stream of Lockheed Hudson twin-engine bombers. It was in September 1940 that the Sperry Bombsight was made available to England. It was Fred Vose and Joseph Saylor who personally took the first two bombsights over to England. Fred Vose was Sperry's aeronautical sales manager and a graduate of Annapolis, class of 1922. Joseph Saylor was a Sperry Field Service representative, and he was a reserve pilot in the United States Marine Corps. It was Joseph Saylor's responsibility to instruct the RAF technicians and officers on the theory and operation of the bombsight. He was at Farnborough and Boscombe Down Experimental Establishment. It was at Boscombe Down that the first bombing mission with the Sperry bombsight was carried out with complete success. It was Wing Commander Charles Dan as bombardier and Flight Lieutenant John Mallinson as pilot flying a Lockheed Hudson at 10,000 feet when they hit a small German supply ship while it was underway at sea. This direct hit was recorded on film, and it was shown in the headline papers at that time, complete with the photos. After 6 months in England, Joseph Saylor was recalled to active service with the U.S. Marine Corps, and I went over to England to replace him. Little did I know when I said goodbye to Joseph Saylor at the Bristol airport that day in April 1941, I was not to see him again. His life ended in Guadalcanal. Shortly thereafter, the 20 Boeing B-17 bombers arrived, and they were based at West Raynham. The commanding officer was Wing Commander Webster, DSO, DFC, and Bar, and the base commander was Group Captain the Earl of Bandon. With the B-17s meant the services of seven Americans. There were two from the Boeing Airplane Company, Dick Rousey and Bob Crawford. Dick Rousey was an aeronautical engineer, and he was there to determine improvements to the aircraft. Many years later on, he became Senior Vice President for Engineering, Boeing Airplane Division, with major responsibilities for the engineering design of that very successful 747 airplane. Bob Crawford was there to instruct the ground crews on the maintenance. Later on, he became manager of Boeing's Field Service Department. There were three officers from the United States Army Air Corps, Major Bill Walsh, Captain Jim Connolly, and Lieutenant Philip Bradley. They instructed the British pilots during their transitional training. And to round out the seven Americans, there were two from the Sperry Gyroscope Company, Fred Vose and myself. At that time, I was a Sperry Field Service Engineer, and my responsibilities were to instruct the RAF officers on the theory and operation of the Sperry bombsight, and also the Sperry automatic pilot, which the bombsight controlled during the bombing run. The aircraft was a Boeing B-17C model, the original design. The defensive armament consisted of one machine gun out the nose and two hand-controlled 50 caliber guns in the side waist position. The latter two guns were absolutely useless unless the enemy flew in formation, which of course never happened. You will see in the film today there are no guns in the tail, no upper local turret, no lower ball turret, no remote control chin turret, all of which were added when we flew them later on in the war as the B-17G. For those of you who recall the 1,000 plane raids, we were a very small force indeed. Of the original aircraft, one was destroyed by fire on the ground, one broke up at altitude during a bombing run and killing my friend Lieutenant Follett Bradley. One was loaned to the Boscombe-Down Experimental Establishment, and we were never able to put more than three planes over Germany at one time. Most of the bombing raids were done with a single B-17. During that period of World War II, in 1941, all of the bombing by both the Germans and the British was carried on during the night. And after the Battle of Britain in 1940, the skies over England were free of enemy aircraft during the daytime. These B-17s are the very beginning of successful daytime bombing at high altitude with great accuracy. The Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., in their Paul Garber facility at Silver Hill just outside Washington, has preserved the B-17C. When I was down there with the Long Island Early Flyers Club, we checked the serial number of that fuselage, and that Smithsonian airplane is the same type as you will see in the film today. Just one last thought. I returned home from England back to the United States 1 week after Pearl Harbor, and this film was edited shortly thereafter. So this film reflects the feeling of that period prior to Pearl Harbor, before the United States entered the war. So now you will see Fred Vose, Joseph Saylor, and me, and some of our experiences in England.
September 1940, certain critical items of aircraft armament equipment were made available to Great Britain for use by the Royal Air Force. As representatives of the American manufacturer, two of us were given the opportunity of accompanying this apparatus and left New York in a chartered commercial airliner en route to England. We looked forward to the privilege of observing the wartime conditions under which these instruments would be used, and hope to learn much that might be of value to us in the design of aeronautical and aircraft armament equipment. Arriving at Rockcliffe Aerodrome in Ottawa, we were met by Group Captain Pierce of the Royal Air Force and his staff. The ribbons that Pierce wore on his tunic were tangible evidence that he had seen his share of active service in two wars. With our luggage securely lashed down in a Hudson, we took to the air on the second leg of our journey, bound for Halifax. Group Captain Pierce, at the controls, had recently come over from England on a special mission for the British Air Ministry. Fresh from a recent formation attack on the Scharnhorst off Norway, for which he was decorated with the Distinguished Service Order, he was able to relate to us many of the exploits of the Hudson and of other American aircraft. The dull camouflage on our Hudson gave a warlike appearance in sharp contrast to the sleek and shining exterior of the flight research plane in which we and our associates had been flying for many months. The peaceful sunshine in which we were flying was in equally sharp contrast to the stormy Atlantic, which we were to face for the next 11 days. Flying above the clouds, under control of the gyro pilot, we suddenly encountered an enemy for which we were unprepared. A wasp, which had been hibernating in the cockpit, came to life and carried out a determined attack upon the group captain. So that the risk of loss at sea might be minimized, we had divided the equipment into two lots and stowed it snugly below in the warhead magazines of two newly commissioned overage destroyers that had, the week before, been transferred to the Royal Navy by the United States government. Our first 2 days at sea gave us an opportunity to acquire our sea legs and to adapt ourselves to the continuous pitching and tossing which the wintry North Atlantic was to give us during the next 9 eventful days. The officers were an outstanding lot, a skipper with years of experience, a first lieutenant, well initiated by a swim ashore from the torpedoed Royal Oak. They were to prove their resourcefulness when our destroyer began to exhibit symptoms of the rheumatic afflictions acquired during 20 years of idleness. Crew was composed of youngsters of the Royal Naval Reserve, few of whom had been to sea before their trip over from England on the Duchess of Bedford, when our destroyer began executing the gyrations that are characteristic of small ocean craft. Many of them doubtless envied their brothers who had selected the infantry as the proper path to glory. The ships would be completely refitted with modern armament upon arrival at some port in the British Isles. But during this voyage, we were expected to face, with the means at hand, whatever enemy we encountered. Interest back home is on the presidential election. Our interest is centered on a radio report of 11 ships sunk. The German raider, the Admiral Scheer, is reported 150 miles away. We are ordered to intercept if possible, shadow by day, and attack by night. During a fruitless search for the Admiral Scheer, I tried to soothe my ruffled nerves by reading. Some sample titles from the ship's library. Death stalks the fleet. Danger is my business. Men against death. On the bottom. And I married adventure. We saw the Empire Dorado, bombed by a German plane which, after looking us over, turned away before we could open fire. Near the coast, a large enemy bomber circled above us, engines droning menacingly. After a trial shot, he dropped one which burst 100 yards abeam. Then a tremendous jar lifted us bodily, but not a bomb. Only one of our own depth charges, released accidentally. What a relief to sight a friendly coastline. Although we had escaped damage from enemy action, we had been the victims of minor mishaps. One ship's radio had been out of commission throughout the trip. Our own steering engine had broken down the first day out. For a day, we steered with the main engines, then steered by hand for 3 days while making repairs. Our gyro compass rolled out of its binnacle in a heavy storm. All three destroyers arrived somewhat battered, with fuel almost exhausted. Belfast Harbor presented a warlike appearance. A sunken wreck showed that here, too, the war was serious business. We passed a newly commissioned aircraft carrier. We said goodbye and went ashore. Two American civilians who had crossed the Atlantic on ex-American destroyers, landing on the 22nd anniversary of the armistice. Our first day in London enabled us to revise our ideas of what life in a heavily bombed city was like. The business of getting on with the war was and is the principal aim in life and furnished the single topic of conversation. The daily existence went on as usual, and not one pessimistic or defeatist sentiment was ever heard. London had gone through one bad winter of war and was ready for another. Along the fringes of Hyde Park could be seen the results of the incessant pounding that London had been receiving for many months. Balloon barrages were a constant reminder of London at war. Clearing the debris in an orderly fashion had become a habit. Every crumbled brick added to that pile in Hyde Park meant just that much more determination to win the war. Wherever possible, the damage was quickly and efficiently repaired. The picturesque English villages offered us changes of scenery that seemed far removed from aerial warfare. It was difficult to realize that here in these peaceful spots there must be increasing vigilance, that the blackout was a necessity, and that the enemy was separated from us by less than an hour's flight. We met and talked with the English people, listened to the exploits of their sons in service. Everywhere we were met with questions showing interest in America, of America's attitude toward the war, and of America's aid that must come in ever-increasing quantity. In every village and in every home, there was the same courageous viewpoint. Even here, there were signs of war. Military equipment on the highway, roadblocks at strategic points, open fields rendered unfit for landings by means of ditches, or by obstructions such as mounds of earth, tree trunks, or even antiquated motor cars. Greeted us. Barbed wire entanglements surrounding the airdromes, innumerable varieties of military aircraft, and our first view of bomb shelters. We became acquainted with the personnel with whom we were to be associated, set up our equipment for initial tests, and prepared for lecture courses to technical personnel. The collection of enemy aircraft shot down in combat and brought here for detailed study was of special interest to us. Here was indisputable evidence of more than a few instances where superior RAF marksmanship had been demonstrated. We took full advantage of the opportunity to examine these aircraft and to study the carefully prepared analytical reports on their instruments. As we examined the self-sealing oil and fuel tanks, we began to appreciate some of the many problems presented in warfare that are all too likely to be overlooked by aircraft and instrument designers too far removed from the scene of combat. Mm-hmm. aircraft of types that had already made their names famous were available for examination. Here was opportunity to learn the needs of the military flyer in a measure limited only by our capacity to absorb the lessons that were placed before us. We compared our American designs of equipment with the efforts of British technicians who had been working on the same problems. We learned how equipment, ideally suited for fair weather peacetime conditions, had been found wanting in the final and conclusive test that is a war to be fought to the finish. We talked with Royal Air Force officers, veterans of the Battle of Britain, and of many night raids on Hamburg, Mannheim, Hamm, and other German targets. We listened to their advice, and we learned much. One of the RAF officers stationed at the Royal Aircraft Establishment was the center of interest when he prepared to fly the twin-engined Messerschmitt 110. With three Canadians, we watched the last-minute preparations. The officer on the left was wearing the Distinguished Flying Cross, bestowed upon him after his 40th night raid on Hamburg. We had, of course, heard so much of this German plane and of its companion, the Messerschmitt 109, that we were very anxious to see it in flight. When captured, it was only slightly damaged. We were told of another Messerschmitt 110, which had been landed at a British airdrome in broad daylight by its youthful German pilot. Already sick of the war, he had chosen this as an easy way to get away from it all, contributing at the same time an undamaged plane to his British captors. Contrary to early reports that had reached us in the United States, we learned that the German planes were well equipped with a complete quota of instruments of the latest type, and that they were easy to fly, though not as maneuverable as some British types. We heard that oil and fuel found in German planes were of inferior quality, but this report, too, proved to be without foundation. All in all, the Messerschmitt 110 was considered to be a formidable opponent. Quite understandably, it was always accompanied on flights by its Hurricane escort, so that no overzealous British pilot, quick to recognize an enemy aircraft, would shoot it down in flames. Beaverbrook made it possible for us to make special trips to many scenes of Air Force activity. We flew to an RAF station in one of the Hudsons in which we were conducting our flight tests. Our pilot on this occasion was Wing Commander Kuhn, who had won the Air Force Cross for his part in the long-range, non-stop, overwater flight to Australia in 1938, establishing the world's record. Mr. Ivor Bowen, Deputy Director of Armament Research, accompanied us on this and other visits. His cooperation contributed materially to the value of our stay in England. We talked with the crews before takeoff. We found them willing to tell us of their troubles, to discuss the difficulties of their problems, and the shortcomings of equipment designed in peacetime. We were convinced that the personnel of the Royal Air Force would compare favorably with any in the world. Their morale was excellent, their courage superb. At Boscombe Down Aerodrome, we conducted final flight tests of our equipment. Here, in surroundings of messroom congeniality, we could meet and talk with technical officers of the RAF, officers who combined, to a marked degree, the qualifications of the engineer and of the practical fighting man. From the watch office at Boscombe Down, an observer could witness the operation of the greatest variety of military aircraft to be seen in the world today. A Jerry came around one day and did this with a stray bomb, scattering a few incendiaries here and there, but an occasional incident like this is all in the day's work. The general appearance of a British aerodrome gives the effect of a gigantic mirage. This is to be expected, where concealment and camouflage are carried to their most effective extreme. Here one sees no well-polished metallic surfaces, no well-lighted hangars. Every building, every plane, every roadway and every runway is painted with dull drabs, greens and black to merge into the landscape and to escape notice from the prying eyes of the enemy reconnaissance. We flew an aircraft of many types and listened with interest to stories of the test of new engines, new instruments, and new armament. We marveled at the quickness with which the need for improvement was recognized. But the answer was plain. Here were those who had already fought in aerial battles, battles which taught bitter lessons, lessons often learned only at the cost of valuable lives lost in combat. There is no thought here of service tests of the peacetime variety. Equipment brought here quickly finds itself in action against an enemy who is not to be underrated. Aircraft gun emplacements, inconspicuous from the air, are manned by alert and well-trained crews and are scattered at strategic points all about the aerodromes. So much to be learned here that only by remaining for months can the observer hope to absorb the wealth of experience that is available. Even then, one leaves with regret because each day brings new problems and new ideas for their solution. These ideas, some good, some bad, when proposed to the personnel at Boscombe Down, receive quick and frank appraisal. We noticed one thing of particular significance. The war had taught one all-important lesson to these technicians. A machine is only one half of a team, and it is the effectiveness of man and machine that counts. The motto hanging over the desk of one of the high-ranking officers of Bomber Command often came to our minds. It closed with these lines, "But the optimist inventor should remember if he can, though the instrument be perfect, there are limits to the man." Our preliminary flight tests were conducted at medium altitude in Hudson bombers. Our crews were veterans, fresh from operations with the Coastal Command. Wing Commander Dan, outstanding expert on these instruments, was in charge. With such experienced personnel, the work went ahead rapidly. Each member of the group, on almost every flight, was able to offer valuable suggestions for improvement in design or in operating technique. The flights, sometimes three or four per day, were rather arduous after they ceased to be a novelty. But we were always encouraged by the thought that here, at first hand, we were learning the conditions under which military equipment must be used in combat. We saw many points of historical interest, such as the ancient Druid ruins at Stonehenge. Salisbury, with its cathedral spire, provided a beautiful view from the air and contained many points of interest. Occasionally, we saw a bomb crater. We examined the aircraft turrets carefully, operating them in the air as well as on the ground. We spent several days in the plants of the principal turret manufacturers. They were extremely cooperative in helping us, as newcomers in the field of aircraft armament, to avoid the mistakes that are inevitable in initial developments in a new field. Power-controlled guns had already played an important part in aerial warfare, and in many engagements had been the deciding factor. Results were analyzed carefully. To conclude the test, an operational flight was made with complete success. At last, after years of patient research and development, our equipment had been in action. The first fortress to arrive from America was made available almost immediately for use in the high-altitude trials that would be the final and conclusive test of our prized equipment. Fortress introduced us, first of all, to the experience of living in a near vacuum. The physiological and psychological factors involved in flying at altitudes above 35,000 feet are many. Those who have not, day after day, witnessed the practical difficulties involved in substratosphere flying cannot appreciate the debt that the aeronautical world owes to those who are doing that flying. Until the last year, there had been but little operation at extremely high altitudes. But with the advent of the high-ceiling fighter, it became necessary to force the bomber still higher. Whenever possible, we operated above 32,000 feet. We tested all items of equipment as exhaustively as possible. The flights were entirely satisfactory, and we were delighted to find no fundamental difficulties. Accompanied by Group Captain Busk of the Directorate of Training, we visited the Air Armament School. The purpose of this visit was to meet the staff of the school, to discuss with them their training methods, and to formulate a plan of training on our own newly adopted equipment. We operated many of their turrets, fired at moving practice targets from their various types of gun emplacements, and made a careful examination of all of their types of ground training equipment. Our group of American representatives arrived. Commanding the squadron was Wing Commander Webster, DSO, DFC, and Barr. Many members of this squadron had served in Blenheims, where their low-altitude raids had contributed some of the most daring exploits of the war. As a part of his training, each man had undergone physical tests in a decompression chamber, where he was closely observed during a five-hour period under conditions simulating flight at 35,000 feet. When all of the major problems of substratosphere flight are solved, the work of the airmen who must fight at these tremendous heights will still be difficult enough. But now, with many unknown hazards confronting him, it is necessary for him to go up daily to the edge of a new world and fight and learn at one and the same time. Electrically heated suits are worn over heavy clothing, and with the many items such as portable oxygen tanks, life preserver, parachute, and so forth, dressing for a flight is a lengthy task. Contrary to what we had expected, there is no apparent nervousness or tenseness among the crews just before takeoff, except for the inevitable confusion that goes with last-minute preparations. Even with the best of preliminary planning, there is a complete normalcy about the entire proceeding. Transportation to the aircraft, which are widely distributed about the aerodrome, is by lorry. Even the Red Cross, which indicates that the vehicle does double duty, does not seem to disturb the nerve of these chaps, who refer to it somewhat affectionately, though callously, as the meat wagon. Provide a fitting conclusion to our work in England, one of our group was given the unique privilege of accompanying a Flying Fortress crew on a daylight raid. Prior to this operational flight, two experiences in the decompression chamber had provided an opportunity to study the physical effects of an extended stay at extreme altitude. We had made many flights over England where we had investigated various conditions, and there remained only one situation in regard to which we had no first-hand knowledge. What are the sensations of an airman flying far into enemy territory in daylight? How will these sensations affect the operation of complex equipment? What are the difficulties of unforeseen conditions that present themselves? These and 100 other questions had arisen in our minds on different occasions. A single trip, while insufficient to provide all the answers, could nevertheless give us an insight that we had not had before. While the ground crews make last-minute checks, put the last items of equipment on board, the members of the flight crew man their stations. A last-minute adjustment of the oxygen mask, which is man's best friend when he climbs up to where the air is much too thin, and we are ready to go. From the nose of the plane, we get a last view. The pilot and co-pilot receive the signal to taxi out, and and we move down the runway. There are three of us in company, one bound for Kiel, one for Wilhelmshaven, while we are bound for Bremen. We will fly in company for a part of the distance across the North Sea, separate at a pre-selected point, and then proceed independently to our separate objectives. To experience, or even to witness, the takeoff of a bomber on an operational trip provides a thrill that is not soon forgotten. As we roll down the runway, we may well wonder what form of adventure will be in store for us. Ice, thunderstorms, enemy fighter interception, or anti-aircraft fire. Which will it be for us, and what will be our luck? Our two companions are off, climbing rapidly toward the rendezvous that has been designated. We turn at the end of the runway and prepare for the long run that is necessary with such a tremendous load. From the bomber's window, we see the ground rushing past at a dizzy speed, and we are off for Germany. The pilot signals, wheels up, and we circle the field once in a climbing turn. Then point eastward and begin to climb. We join the other two fortresses, fly in company with them, and settle down for a five-hour ordeal. Of the nose compartment, with the heat turned off in the hope of avoiding frosting of the windows, cools off rapidly. In the space of an hour, the temperature drops from the 115 degrees Fahrenheit of the cabin in which we had sweltered before the takeoff. When we touch 35,000 feet, it is minus 67 degrees. Our two companions are forced by the weather conditions near their respective targets to turn back while we push on to Bremen. As we approach the vicinity of our objective, the ground is still invisible beneath the solid blanket of clouds. The navigator passes the word to stand by. We will be over Bremen in 2 minutes. Simultaneously, the interphone brings word that anti-aircraft fire has commenced astern of us. A quick succession of last-minute orders from the pilot, and we turn from the camera to the operation of the equipment which for so many months had been our charge. The crew are in high spirits as we turn toward home. With the nervous tension of the first half of the trip behind him, our observer can begin to appreciate the opportunities that have been his. He has been the first American to make an operational trip in the Flying Fortress, and the first American to fly into Germany on a long-range daylight raid. We fly close to the water after we reach the middle of the North Sea, and the warmth of the cabin is a welcome relief. We'll be right back. of the peaceful English countryside will welcome us, and we will be safely home. Circle over the field, contact the watchtower by radio, and glide in for a landing. Immediately upon landing, we are surrounded by ground crews and by members of other flight crews, eager with questions about our mission. We are relieved to learn that our companions have returned safely. The rear gunner gives an account of the unfriendly reception that had been given us at Bremen in the form of anti-aircraft fire. We in the nose compartment had been so busily engaged at the time that we had not realized from the laconic reports over the interphone that the fire had been so intense and the accuracy so nearly effective. We then proceed to headquarters for a formal interrogation. A typical day's work is finished. The conclusion of this memorable flight, which was to mark the end of our visit, we felt a deep regret at terminating our association with those splendid lads of the Royal Air Force, who, day after day, continue their gallant fight.